Today's episode of the IC109 podcast is brought to you by two quotes. It's brought to you by Larry Wiggs, but inspired. That's what I should have said. Inspired by two quotes. And here they go.
There's a commitment to the long haul. This is not about capturing a market share of audience, because that's what everyone's doing, right? So when you see, you know, breaking news, it's about your algorithms, it's about the clicks, it's about getting the numbers so that you can get the advertisers, so you can, and now we're feeding a beast and not the people.
Teach.
So when you come into a space and you're building a media outlet that says Black on it, but it's not really about Black people, it's about, again, grabbing Black people, not feeding Black people, you're going to always fail. Your presentation was all about numbers and this and that, but not about what are you giving us that we don't already have, which means you haven't even done your homework.
And the second quote is?
Long-winded, running through this life like it was mine. Never settling, but setting every goal high. 1,000 burpees on the path to my own destruction or success. But what is a mistake without the lesson? See, the best teacher in life is your own experience. None of us know who we are until we fail. They say every man is defined by his reaction to any given situation. Well, who would you want to define you? Someone else or yourself? Whatever you do, homie, give your heart to it and stay strong.
Please enjoy this episode of the IC109 podcast. I'm your host, Larry Wiggs. Welcome to another episode of the IC109 podcast. I'm your host, Larry Wiggs. Today, I'd like to talk about the month of March. To begin with, I would like to say that the poem 10-9 was birthed in March of 2019. However, it was conceived in the months or the years between 2016 and 2018, during which I lived in Saudi Arabia. So conceived in Saudi Arabia between 2016 and 2018, but birthed in Oman in March of 2019. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, the conception came in the form of a dream. Up until 2016, I had a collection of experiences whereby I encountered the numbers 10 and 9, and they stuck with me. I documented those moments, and after having so many experiences, I wanted to tell these stories about these encounters. And between 2016 and 2018, probably 2016 or 2017, but anyway, it's between those years, I was living in Saudi Arabia, and one day I had a dream in which I saw 109 in white on a red cover, or on the back, red in the background, white letters, and I thought, that's the cover of my book. It came to me in a dream. I got it. Now, at that time, all I had were a collection of encounters, photos, stories, all about these numbers, 10 and 9. I didn't have any clue how I was going to connect these dots. I didn't have any idea how I would connect these dots until 2019 March. So that's why I say that it was my poem 10-9, this story, was birthed at that time, because in 2019, in March, I was living in the Sultanate of Oman, and a number of events occurred during the month of March that culminated in an event that really, it was the tipping point. It was like, now you have the story that fits inside that book, or that fits, you know, under that cover. I thought, oh, okay, I got it now. So what was that? Well, I guess you have to read the book in order to know exactly. But those are the events. That's the story, basically. That's the story. That's how 10-9 came about. But then the reason why I wanted to make this podcast is because of the month of March. And all of the events that are mentioned in the poem occurred in the month of March. Okay, what are those events? Starting with number one, on March 1st, the Battle of Adwa. I said battle. I hope you can hear me. Battle. All right. The Battle of Adwa was decisively won by the Ethiopians on March 1st. I believe the year was 1896. All right. And I'm sitting in front of the computer, so I will actually confirm that date, that year, excuse me. Yes, 1896. Woo, okay. Oh, no. It started, the war started March 1st, 1896. That was the beginning of the war. Excuse me. Okay. I think in other podcasts, I may have said that the war was decisively won. It ended that day, but it began. Okay. Now, the victory went to the Ethiopians whenever the war ended, which I should be able to check on Wikipedia right now, but let me just continue so that I don't belabor this podcast. Yeah, so the war began March 1st, and it's a significant day for Ethiopians because Ethiopians are taught about the Battle of Adwa, and it's a source of pride for Ethiopians. It's interesting. Well, why is it a source of pride? Because it's a definitive. It is the victory of an African nation over a colonizing European nation. And the way that it was told to me, it's the only one. So all other African nations fell but Ethiopia. And for that reason, Ethiopia becomes or is looked at, is treated as a beacon of hope for all Africans or for all colonized people. In other words, Ethiopia is like, if Ethiopia can do it, then we can do it. Then we can survive. And Ethiopia is a very strong nation, even though today it is quite impoverished. Ethiopia is very wealthy. There's a wealth of history, a wealth of culture, a wealth of diversity, genetic diversity. There's so many reasons to admire, to laud Ethiopia. And that's it. Now, the Battle of Adwa was the definitive, when it did end, it was definitively an Ethiopian victory over a colonizing Italy. Okay, so Italy tried to squash them. So in my case, when I learned about this victory, a great sense of pride washed over me, and I was curious to wonder why this was hidden from me, why this history, why I had never learned of this history, or why even the importance of Ethiopia had never been stressed by anyone really in my life. Because if having had Ethiopia stressed, the importance of Ethiopia stressed in my life, I perhaps would have had, you know, I don't know. Who knows? But maybe I would have had a greater interest in history. Maybe I would have had a greater interest in maybe politics. But who knows? Anyhow, it was March 1st that the Battle of Adwa was won. And the battle was so significant in Ethiopians' lives, so significant in African lives, so significant that marked the month of March, especially for me in 2019, because I knew about the Battle of Adwa after having traveled to Ethiopia and learning about the battle during a tour. I was a tourist. They taught me about the Battle of Adwa, and that was quite an impressive tidbit to learn. And so when March 1st rolled around in 2019, see, my travels to Ethiopia occurred in 2017, the first travels. But I tell you, after that first journey to Ethiopia, I was hooked, and I just kept going back as often as I could. Remember, I was living in Saudi Arabia at the time. All right. So Battle of Adwa was basically at the front of my mind in March of 2019. So I was riding high on that victory, thinking, hey, man, the Ethiopians, dude, they did it, you know, more hundreds of years ago. All right. And then 9 days after, there was the crash of the Ethiopian Airlines. Ethiopian Airlines Flight 302. That was on March 10th of 2019. So here we go with another number 10. 9 days following the Battle of Adwa victory that's being celebrated, you have Ethiopian Airlines Flight 302 crashing. And now, so we went from elation, from feeling very happy about the event. I would say Ethiopians felt that way, but myself, you know, as an extension, because I learned about the Battle of Adwa, so there I was happy, but I was in Oman at the time, not Saudi Arabia. I was in Oman, 2019. All right. And so, yeah, 9 days later, March 10th, the airplane crashed, devastating many people's lives, many families of Ethiopians, but also of international figures. I believe Ralph Nader's granddaughter was on the flight, as well as a Kenyan, my goodness, I should know. There was a very popular Kenyan leader on that flight. All right. I'm looking at the Wikipedia page. You can do the same to read more about it. Anyhow, the crash was devastating, and it was it made international news because this was a Boeing airliner, and Boeing had a darn good reputation, a darn good track history. Boeing Airlines or Boeing airplanes didn't just fall out of the sky, and the Ethiopian Airlines crash was the second crash to occur of a Boeing airliner. The first being in, was it Thailand? See, I should have all my details prepared. I should know my stuff. I'm so eager to make these podcasts. And anyhow, the Ethiopian Airlines flight, that was a Boeing airline. And then I'll say that Netflix has recently produced a documentary about the Boeing Airlines crash. I'm looking at Netflix right now, and they're showing a big Bridgerton something. All right.
It's been a bad year for Boeing and a better year for its European competitor, Airbus. For the year, Boeing has 368 new orders and Airbus has 427.
All right, so that's just a snippet. That's where I left off in the documentary. And, okay, so it's called something.
Got to be taken.
Downfall, The Case Against Boeing. All right, so you can check it out on Netflix. They'll talk about it and then they'll go into it, okay? So there's some relevance, all right, to today. People are still talking about it. People are still affected of it. Of course, when you lose, when lives are lost like that, yes, you know, it makes the news. All right, so back to my story. So there's one event on the 1st, and then there's another event on March 10th, both of which captivated my attention. All right, not to mention the numerological value of these events on 9 days apart on March 10th. Like, wow, 10-9, there it is again. All right, so in March of 2019, I'm squarely focused on Ethiopia. All right, now let's move on from that, because those events didn't affect me directly. I was a teacher, an English teacher in Oman, and because I was teaching in Oman, I mean, those events didn't really affect me. They were in the news, but that was about it. Moving on, I was having my own personal experiences while in the desert of all places. I was alone. I was often staring at the sky, into the at the stars. Usually I would go on to my roof at night, and Oman is alcohol friendly country, unlike Saudi Arabia. So I had a bottle of rum that I would drink on occasion, mix it with some Coke, have a rum and Coke. I had been to Cuba, so I was reminiscing about my Cuban days, and I also had Cuban cigars with me. So I was atop my roof, atop my home on the roof, puffing on my Cuban cigar, sipping my Cuba Libre, or rather rum and Coke, because I didn't have lime to make it specifically a Cuba Libre. And so that's how I would spend my time in Oman. And I would just, you know, think about my life, think about the events, the current events, and I probably should have been preparing for my lessons, because they eventually fired me from my position. So that's something to think about. But hey, when I left Oman, I had my poem, I had my book. So there was the purpose of me going to Oman was greater than just having a job, just working. It was so much greater, because it's led me down this path, which is so much more rewarding and fulfilling. Not financially, a job will financially, you know, support you and all, but this is far more rewarding. Okay, as I was saying, I was in the desert, and I just started having a lot of experiences, from encountering the goat that I mentioned in the book 10-9, you know, as well as taking a very peculiar photo in which I was wearing one sock on my right foot. There were those two events. Oh, and then of course, on the last day of the month, in the month of March of 2019, the murder of Nipsey Hussle, who I saw Nipsey as being a great spirit, a great person whose death, whose murder was so unexpected and so shocking, and that the idea that he was able to capture the imaginations or capture the attention of people around the globe, really, I found vexing, because I thought, but he was just from Crenshaw and Slauson, and I grew up in LA, so I was quite familiar with Crenshaw and Slauson, and I thought, how could he do it? How could he become world famous? How could he have the impact that he had around the globe when he was a high school dropout? He was a gang member. How did he captivate this much attention and touch so many, the hearts of so many people, hearts and minds? And then it dawned on me after having another experience actually on the day that Nipsey was murdered, whereby I saw the numbers 10 and 9, that I kind of had confirmation that Nipsey wasn't just some gangbanger from Los Angeles who dropped out of high school, sold drugs, and became famous internationally. He was a divine spirit. This is the conclusion I arrived at. I felt too strongly about the coincidence of having seen 10-9 on that day, because I couldn't explain why there were only two cars on the road, and the other car had the license plate 10-9 on it. And I thought, how come I keep finding these numbers, 10-9, the way that I do? And how come I saw it on the day of Nipsey's murder? Within an hour or two of having learned of Nipsey's murder, I'm driving to work and there are no cars on the road but mine and this one other vehicle. And that other vehicle had 10-9 on the license plate. The license plate specifically read 1090. 1019. So I'm like, yo, that is an unbelievable coincidence, because those numbers, I mean, I had already had a dream a year or two before whereby I had realized I'm going to write a book. The conception, the idea, the book was conceived then. But then Nipsey and 10-9 put together on a particular day really solidified it for me. It said, your book is about Nipsey. Your book is about divinity. Your book is not only about numerology, because that's where it was before then, but your book is greater than all of that. Your book is about history. It's about Adwa. Okay, now why did I bring up Adwa? Because of Nipsey's heritage. Nipsey was Eritrean. Now, you're probably thinking, but Eritrea and Ethiopia are two different countries. They're separate countries. That's true. And then that's when I have to invoke the history of Aksum. Maybe even I have to invoke the history of Punt and Dumt. These are empires that spanned the territory that we know of today as separate countries, Ethiopia and Eritrea. You see, at one time, those countries were one. They were united. And essentially, the people were one and the same. And so, if you know that, you can get past all of the mud, all of the noise, and you can see clearly who Nipsey was and how Ethiopia is associated with Nipsey. Dividing, you know, that's part of the conqueror's mentality and mission. But our mission is to unify, is to go beyond the noise, go beyond the mud, and see clearly what we are seeing. So we have to rise above all of that garbage, and we have to see clearly, who are these people, all right, and what do they actually represent? So Nipsey was a unifier. Nipsey was unifying Bloods and Crips. That's one aspect of Nipsey. Nipsey was showing us a way that we hadn't been shown by anyone else, or rather by few people in Los Angeles. What I mean by that is, if you look at New York, you had rising stars like Biggie Smalls, who's similar to Nipsey, was cut down in his prime. But then Biggie was on his rise as a king, you know, for New York, and he certainly was called it, and and advertised, promoted as the king of New York, as far as rap goes. But we also have people like Diddy or Sean Puffy Combs, and of course, Jay-Z. And if we look at their careers, then we can see, hey, these guys made it to the top. And how did they do it? How can we follow their example? Well, you'd have to be a darn good rapper or a darn good producer. You'd have to be hungry to, you know, recreate the accomplishments of either men. But those guys that I mentioned are on the East Coast. And even the East Coast had Russell Simmons. I mean, and Russell Simmons had Steve Stout, Kevin Lyles. Yeah, all of these guys, these heavy hitters coming from the East Coast. But on the West Coast, we had Suge Knight. And I think that was about it. Perhaps you could say Michael Concepcion. Maybe you can say Eazy-E. And then there's also the TDE movement, so maybe Top Dog. But you know, we didn't have anyone who was in front of the camera who was also basically becoming, or you know, a mogul. And Nipsey was in the prime. Nipsey was on Forbes. They had written an article about Nipsey in Forbes magazine. So very much so, Nipsey was that dude. Nipsey was making strides. And because of his success, because of his intellect, he was well read and just a pleasure to listen to because of his wealth of knowledge and his dearth of knowledge, his breadth of knowledge. He was certainly a unique individual, and so his death, his influence, or to me, they were perplexing, and so I could only conclude that he was a divine individual, the divine spirit, to have accomplished so much in so little time, and then for all of it to end the way that it did. But for his message and his legacy to live on, it's a tremendous accomplishment, and it's a testament not only to the life that he lived, but also to the principles he lived by. And Nipsey, in his interviews, would often, well, not even his interviews, but his, not only his interviews, but his music as well, was influenced by and injected, you know, his spiritual and religious leanings. He mentions God. He mentions reading the Bible. And taken together, I said, man, this dude was anointed. And then his name? His name was Hermias, which, if you check on Google, translates to God will rise, or sent by God. You have these two definitions. Those are the two definitions I personally found. Sent by God and God will rise. God will rise was tattooed on his face. And so the godly nature, the spiritual nature, the numerological significance, seeing these numbers on that particular day when Nipsey was murdered. Okay, all of these things were working on me to lead me in a direction. That direction was to write the book, write the poem, and that's it, you know? And then once I had written it, it was complete in Oman. I had copies printed in Sri Lanka, and then they were mailed to me while I was in Oman. Then I knew what I had to do. I had to develop this story. I had to share the story. I had to print copies of this book. I had to promote it. I had to, the book, you know, has a life of its own. And it's my mission and my purpose to promote it and to get it out there, to spread it. So we are now at the stage where I have a podcast, the IC109 podcast. I'll tell you some of the stories when I encountered these numbers. But the mission is to share this story. Let me see. I was just thinking about it. What is the purpose? What am I doing with this? Okay, I'm making videos. Yes, today's inspiration has come from the Dr. Greg Carr and the Karen Hunter show on YouTube. They weekly meet. They meet weekly to discuss, topics on Saturdays. And so they said something very peculiar. Let me read. I stopped it while I was listening to them. Listen to what Karen Hunter said.
And not the people.
Teach.
So when you come into a space and you're building a media outlet that says black on it, but it's not really about black people. It's about, again, grabbing black people, not feeding black people. You're going to always fail. Your presentation was all about numbers and this and that, but not about what are you giving us that we don't already have, which means you haven't even done your homework.
Boom. Now, Karen Hunter was talking about the numbers in terms of the algorithms, you know, building communities in entertainment. But when she spoke about the numbers, I took that personally, because I took that personal to say, Larry, you're focusing too much on these numbers. You need to teach your community. You need to share with your community what you know. And so that's where I am now. After listening to the In Class with Carr, episode 107, at the 11 minute and 37 second mark, Karen Hunter just finished her statement about numbers. And when I began playing that clip, Dr. Carr said, teach, in support of what Karen Hunter was about to say. But that when Dr. Carr said teach, I heard that clearly in my soul, because he's saying, brother, you have to teach us. You can't just talk about these numbers. That's what Karen Hunter said, but Dr. Carr said teach, and I felt that. So that's what I'm doing right now. Let's skip to documentary.org. Documentary.org has an article written on October 7th, 2021, entitled Transmitting Unrecorded Black Histories, The Documentaries of Haile Gerima by Aaron E. Hunt. And I'm going to read to you the first paragraph of this article, because Haile Gerima, Howard University professor and the owner of Sankofa Books in Washington, D.C., across the street from Howard University. Haile Gerima is a filmmaker, and in addition to his Sankofa film released in the 1990s, in 1993, he also made Adwa, An African Victory. And the fact that Haile Gerima, an Ethiopian American, made a movie about Adwa underscores the significance of this battle. So I'm going to read the first paragraph. It goes, "Did the Ethiopians really defeat the white men at the Battle of Adwa? Or was the victory simply boasting?" Haile Gerima asked his father as a young boy. Shouting war songs and harnessing their traditional art of war skills, shaking spears and swinging swords, the Ethiopian patriots tangled the enemy, his father assured him. Any time an Italian bullet hit them, they exclaimed, "What flea is this?" Gerima recreates this exchange in his 1999 documentary on the first Italo-Ethiopian War, Adwa, an African Victory. Over time, Gerima came to understand the drama in the storytelling, the metaphorical meaning of the flea, and the power of generational transmission through the creative arts. His father, Abba Gerima, a historian and playwright from Gondar, dramatized historical events through his plays, in which his son acted and helped advertise. The dramatic elements, chants, and folklore that recounted the war helped enliven the stories in Ethiopian communities across generations, while keeping the historical authenticity intact. Gerima's father's dramatizations helped him embrace the truth of Ethiopia's victory and power. In 1896, Emperor Menelik II's barefooted forces felled the invading Italian army equipped with bolt-action rifles at Adwa. That is the first paragraph of the article. So, it says here, generational, where it is, enliven, all right? It says here, the dramatic elements, the chants and folklore that recounted the war helped enliven the stories in Ethiopian communities across generations. So there it is. The Ethiopians are enlivened when they hear about the Battle of Adwa. Just as when I learned about the Battle of Adwa, I was enlivened. I said, "Oh my gosh, everything that we've learned is untrue. These are all lies." Okay, we are God body. We are the best. You know, you got to build yourself up. You've got to know the history. What you're being told? Oh, you know, you can't. No, you can. If you tap into your star player, as Cat Williams says, tapping into your star player means you've got to know your history. You've got to see the people who have lived before you, and you have to understand and see their strength demonstrated in their lives so that you can find your strength, because you and they are not dissimilar. You are one and the same. So it's important, but it's because we don't know our history, because we don't know these things, of course, we are not enlivened. We are not invigorated. We are what? Wayward. Okay, we'll do that. We'll go this way. We'll do what you say. Yes, we'll do that. We'll do that. No, stand up and fight. Say, no, that's not what my people would do. We would fight. We don't want this. No, we deserve something else. No. And that sort of knowledge of the history, you know, I think that aligns your chakra. It will make you stand tall. Everything will be in place. You'll make better decisions. That's what I think. So the Battle of Adwa. So today is March 26th. And in 5 days will be the anniversary of the tragic end of Nipsey Hussle or Ermias Askedom's life on the 31st. Another year will have gone by, but not without reminiscing, not without marking this time and celebrating it and thinking and remembering the importance of great spirits, of great people and their accomplishments, and knowing and reiterating the idea that you can do it too, that you can be great too, but you don't have to do it the way they say it. That was very pivotal, very important, you know, in Nipsey's life, in his example. He wrote a poem in which he said, who would you rather, you know, tell your story, somebody else or you? And that's so poignant. Who would you rather? What was the name of that song? I have to find it. Who would you rather do this? Google is helpful. Nipsey said, long-winded, running through this life like it was mine. Never settling, but setting every goal high. 1,000 burpees on the path to my own destruction or success. But what is a mistake without the lesson? See, the best teacher in life is your own experience. None of us know who we are until we fail. They say every man is defined by his reaction to any given situation. Well, who would you want to define you? Someone else or yourself? Whatever you do, homie, give your heart to it and stay strong. Man, powerful, extremely powerful words. I think 40 minutes in is about enough. I'm going to end this podcast here. I hope I've given you some things to think about. In the description to this podcast, I will have included the links to the article, as well as Nipsey's lyrics, as well as the in-class, the episode of in-class with Carr on episode 107, which was released today. Thank you for listening to the IC 109 podcast. I'm your host, Larry Wiggs. Enjoy your day.